March on, go who's.
Hello, I'm Samantha. I have cancer. A lot of people know that. So I'm making this video because I don't think a lot of people think about the in-between phase between when someone is diagnosed with cancer and then when they actually start their treatment. So as you know, or maybe you don't know, but anyway, cancer treatment can be completely different for different people based on the type of cancer. So this video is not going to explain how I found out that I had cancer. This is going to explain what happened directly after I found out that I had cancer. If you want to know the story of how I found out I had cancer or the specifics on my diagnosis, I have videos about that. Links are in the description. So basically, I had a biopsy done on a lump in my breast and those results came back and I had cancer. One of the main things that needs to happen is they need to make sure that that cancer has not spread to other parts of the body. So on the day that they told me that I had cancer, I went into the office and they were like, we needed to check under your arm because we need to check your lymph nodes. That's a very common place where breast cancer can spread. So they did an ultrasound under my arm and they found two abnormal looking lymph nodes and they did biopsies on those because they just needed to know whether or not those had cancer because it could affect my treatment. And then I'm just gonna explain it in order of how it happened for me. March 7th was the day that I found out that I had cancer and that I went in for the ultrasound of my arm and the biopsy of the lymph nodes. I met with the breast surgeon that day and she basically gave me a rundown on my cancer. Then the next day on March 8th I had a meeting with my oncologist. He basically went through all the details of the cancer and everything and all the treatment and more details because there's just so many. They tried to schedule as many appointments as they could on the same day so I could miss as few days of work as possible and live like sort of a normal life, but let's face it, it just wasn't normal. You can't, once you find out you have cancer, like that's it, your life's not normal anymore. So it was basically decided that I needed to do chemotherapy, and then there was just a bunch of appointments that came with that that I needed to do before I started chemotherapy to get ready. I didn't start chemo until April 5th, so there was all that time in between. For me, this was kind of the most stressful time because you know you have cancer, but you're not doing anything about it at the moment. On Tuesday, March 12th, I had an appointment of chemo education. Basically, I went in and they explained to me what chemo was and they gave me pieces of paper with all the information about chemo on it, and it was just a really boring appointment. I just remember being so bored and also like, this is crazy stuff, man. Then I needed to have an echocardiogram. I didn't even know what an echocardiogram was. It's like an ultrasound of your heart. Chemotherapy can affect your heart, so they wanted to look at mine and document how it looked right then before I started chemo to make sure that chemo didn't actually do anything to harm my heart. So I got that done, and on the same day I got my port placed. I needed that port put in because that's how I was going to receive chemotherapy. They stick that port every time they are going to give me the medicine because they couldn't give it to me through an IV in my arm because it would tear up all of the veins in my arm. So that was just like a minor surgery. I have another video that explains that. Then the next day on March 13th, I had an appointment with the fertility doctor. Because chemotherapy and the specific type of chemotherapy that I had can damage your ovaries, so it could make it so that I could never have children naturally, so they were discussing the option of me freezing my eggs. It was just really strange for me because I never thought that at age 22, before I'm married, I would be going into a fertility doctor to be discussing possible problems that I could have with pregnancy. It was just something that was just not on my mind at all, and I was just like, wow, this is just stuff that is completely affecting my life. So yeah, I basically had an appointment with her to discuss all of the options that I had for freezing eggs or freezing embryos, which I didn't freeze embryos because why would I do that? Surprise, I have another video on that whole process if you want to know, because I did end up freezing my eggs. And then on that same day, I had my PET scan. I hate scans. They're just so boring. So I had never had any type of scan before I found out that I had cancer. I had never had an MRI. I had never had a CT scan. I had definitely never had a PET scan. I had an x-ray one time. Never had an ultrasound. Never had a mammogram. I actually still have never had a mammogram, which is kind of funny because I have breast cancer, but basically a PET scan is when they inject you with some radioactive dye That's just always fun whenever they say they're gonna inject you with radioactive dye. And then you have to sit in a room for like an hour while that dye moves to the places that it needs to move to. After you get injected with the dye, you lay on this table and it moves you through this big circular tube and it just scans your whole body, and you have to sit there for like an hour or however long it takes. It takes forever. And then when you do the scan, like, problem places will light up. So where my cancer was just lit up brightly for them, they're like, yep, that's where the cancer is. And then if any other areas light up on that scan, they need to check those places more in depth. They originally called me about my scan. They were like, it looks really great. Really, the only areas that lit up were under the arm and in your left breast, because that's where the cancer is. And so it's really good that those are the only areas that lit up, because that means that there's not cancer other places. And then they looked at it again, I guess, and they're like, hey, if you look really closely, there's like a little bit of lit up area in one of your ovaries. So my oncologist was like, do you know if you're ovulating? Because some people can tell if they are. And I was like, no, I literally have no idea. Apparently on some PET scans of young women, ovaries can light up when you're ovulating. So my oncologist was like, it's probably nothing. And the amount that was lit up was apparently still in the normal range of what they consider okay. But it was still lit up more than the area around it. So he was like, just go get a pelvic MRI to be safe. The next day, March 14th, I had to go in for a pelvic MRI. I hate MRIs. It was the first time I had an MRI, but they're the worst. The fertility doctor wanted an extra look at that MRI because she wanted to just make sure there were no problems with my ovaries, because otherwise there might be issues with the egg freezing or whatever. But that MRI came back completely normal, so there was nothing to worry about in my ovaries or any of the area around there. So I just go on with my life, and then later they call me and they say, hey, there's another area that's just lit up a little bit. Apparently my second right rib was lit up a little bit differently. It was also in the normal range of what they considered to be okay, but they were being just extra careful, which I'm very grateful for. So they're like, all right, now we want you to go do a CT scan. So I went in for the CT scan, and every single time I went in for one of these scans, they asked me the same questions every single time. I had to fill out a very similar form every single time, so I had it all down. CT scan was super short. I didn't realize it was that short, because the MRI takes forever. Also, they're so loud. MRIs are so loud. There's nothing about an MRI that is fun. You have to sit still for like an hour, and then you're just shoved into this tiny little space, and then there's all this spinning and noise. So I did the CT scan, and I get a call afterwards, and they're like, your scan looks completely normal. And I'm like, okay, great. So I think that I don't have to think about it again. And then I get a random call while I'm at work, and they're like, hey, we're gonna be setting up your MRI and your bone scan. And I'm like, what? Then the lady on the phone's like, oh, no one's told you about this, have they? And I'm like, no, can you? So they told me that basically, since there was nothing that showed up on the CT scan, they needed to do an MRI because the MRI would give them more information. And they also needed to do a nuclear bone scan. And I'm like, what the heck is that? So I'm like Googling nuclear bone scan. It's just another type of wonderful scan that you can get. On that day that they were scheduling the MRI and the nuclear bone scan, I also had another appointment with my oncologist, just another like checkup appointment. That was March 22nd. And earlier that week, I'd already started going into the fertility office because I started the process of the egg retrieval. I was gonna start having to go in there pretty often, every other day and then every day, to get shots and for them to do a transvaginal ultrasound. And if you care about that whole process, again, I have a video on it. Links in the description. So on that day, they were scheduling the nuclear bone scan, then the MRI, then I was gonna try to get an appointment with the eye doctor just because I needed the eye doctor appointment, but everything ended up taking too long, so I couldn't. And then an appointment with my oncologist. So the bone scan has, surprise, some more dye that needs to be injected. I went in around 8 a.m. and they put an IV in my arm and they injected their dye stuff. but I needed to wait a couple of hours before the scan because the dye needed to go and do its thing, I guess. Then my older sister was actually in the hospital because she needed to get a mammogram because they found breast cancer in me, so they needed to check her. She did not have breast cancer, so all's good there. So I went and hung out with her, and then at 10 a.m. I had my MRI appointment. So they basically had me on the table and strapped everything down, and they were like, okay, so we're just gonna do this one scan, and then we're gonna look at the results of it, and depending on those results, you may have to stay for another scan. I was just really hoping that I was only gonna have to do that one scan, but I didn't. Because it just takes so long. You're just in this tube and there's just all this noise and you're just thinking, when can I get out? There's nothing to do. They should put TVs up there or something so you can watch TV, do something so you're not just sitting there. And I remember I was like getting this pain in my side while I was sitting there, but I couldn't do anything about it because I had to stay still. Here I am complaining to YouTube about how annoying MRIs are. My life is just so hard, you guys. I was just so bored that I just decided maybe I can fall asleep during this and then it'll go faster. So I kept falling asleep, but then, you know, I kept waking up because it's so dang loud. So I would fall asleep for a little while, wake up for a little while, and then finally the MRI was done. They were like, hey, you missed your eye doctor appointment. We called them for you and told you we weren't gonna make it. I'm like, that's so nice of you guys, thanks. Then I went in for the bone scan. The bone scan, I think, was there to determine whether there was new bone growth. Basically, the bone scan is like the same type of thing. You're laying on a table, but this time there's just like this thing that's rotating around you that's taking images and stuff. What they found out from all those scans was that there was something specifically on the rib that it looked different on the MRI from all the other ribs that were there. But the bone scan showed that there was no new bone growth or anything there. They don't know if there's cancer there or if that rib just for some reason didn't develop the same way as my other ribs, really. But they found out exactly where it was, and based on where it is, it's too hard to biopsy that area. So they're gonna do some sort of laser radiation thing on that spot just because the risk of biopsying it is just not worth it. So then after all that stuff was done, I had the port placed, I had all those scans, I had other baseline things done, I got the eggs out to freeze just in case they would be harmed, I could start chemo. So I could actually finally start killing cancer. So yeah, there you go. That's basically all the stuff that I needed to go through. Obviously, it's completely different for different people based on their scan results. Cancer is a pretty serious thing, so they need to do all the scans and all this stuff to make sure that they know exactly where it is so they know how to treat it. I just wanted to make that video because I don't think that's something that people normally think about, all the stuff that cancer patients have to go through after they find out they have cancer before they even start chemotherapy. And that's just my experience, so hopefully this video was kind of interesting. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel to support me on my cancer adventure. And check out some of the other videos I've done. Follow me on Instagram for more updates on my cancer journey. And yeah, so thanks for watching. Goodbye.